Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Supercommunicator, explaining the complicated so anyone can understand, by Frank J. Pietrucha. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Dedicated to my parents, Frank Anthony and Dorothy Bull Pietrucha. To my dad, the artist who encouraged me to reach for the sky, and my mom, the banker, who taught me to keep both feet firmly planted on the ground. Introduction. An elephant named Digital Communication. This book started out as a how-to guide on communicating complicated topics, but something happened along the way. My plan was to share with you my experiences as a communicator, specializing in helping clients explain subjects that most would consider difficult or complex. My job is to make sure my clients' concepts are articulated in a way that brings meaning to their ideas and turns the complicated into something understandable. I work with engineers, scientists, economists, and others who deal with big numbers and big concepts, and I assist them in molding their hard-to-comprehend content into something that non-specialists, the rest of us, can readily grasp. Too often, potentially great projects are dismissed by management, investors, and regulators simply because those decision-makers can't understand their value. But the communication of complicated ideas isn't just a corporate problem. Many of us shut out new ideas in business and at home when there's even a hint that the concept at hand may be too hard to figure out. Opportunities can be missed, and bad things can happen when content originators don't explain their subjects in easy-to-understand language. There's more need for my services than you can probably imagine. My career has been anything but boring. I have helped engineers at NASA communicate the agency's need for information technology. I have developed campaigns to help officials improve their economies on behalf of George Washington University. I have enabled dozens of startups to simplify their message for investors and potential clients. It's always rewarding to help organizations with interesting but complicated ideas explain themselves to the rest of the world. To broaden the book beyond my own experiences and advice, I interviewed other professional communicators to see what they considered their best practices in communicating the complicated. I met some fascinating people along the way, and all was going fine, but the more interviews I conducted and the more research I did, the more I realized the scope of the book needed to change. There was an elephant in the room with me, staring at me all day as I worked. Despite his mammoth size, I carried on like he wasn't using up all the oxygen in the room. But I couldn't ignore him any longer. He got too big and made too much noise. I knew I had to acknowledge his presence, even if that meant changing the focus of the book. That elephant is named Digital Communication. At the most basic level, new digital tools make it easier for people to access complicated subjects. The recent rise in the use of video, audio, graphics, and interactive features gives content producers the ammunition to fight battles in the name of knowledge. In this book, I will use the term multimedia to describe a broad range of communication tools. Multimedia means any type of presentation that uses both words and graphics. It can be as simple as a poster board with text and a photograph, or it can be something more compelling, like data visualization, which offers us new ways to turn boring data into effective content. Infographics, for example, help us see meaning in things we couldn't otherwise comprehend. And the internet, which has made all of these tools more accessible, has altered not only how we get information, but also how we express ourselves. Digital technology is rewiring our brains and reshaping how we communicate. What I learned from my years of explaining complicated subjects is still extremely useful. All that I do to make technical topics easier for others, from audience awareness to simplicity in writing to employing attention-grabbing techniques, is still essential to my role as a communicator. But digital technology is changing the rules about how we apply our skills in a transforming world. Most of us need to do more thinking about digital technology and how to strategically incorporate it into our communication efforts. No matter what new features come our way, we still need to be mindful of the classic techniques that have been employed by writers and orators for centuries. Winners in the transition from print thinking to digital expression will be people who can transfer classic communication styles to a uniquely modern paradigm. Professionals should learn to communicate with ordinary people, then the common people wouldn't be so common. John L. Beckley. It's important for businesses to articulate who they are and what they do with clarity and meaning in order to survive in a society where complicated material is abundant. Our world is on the cusp of radical change as biotechnology, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, synthetic biology, and other advancements come of age. The digital revolution breaks the centuries-old tradition of knowledge being a precious commodity held by an elite few. The democratization of information is happening. Our job as communicators is to make a larger percentage of our population aware of these game-changing advancements. The digital age is about inclusion, not exclusivity. The internet gives us the power to unite disparate people, and communicators are needed to use the technology to bring meaning to those who seek information. And so, this book is not just about successfully communicating the complicated, but doing so in this new and exciting digital age. It is increasingly the case that failing to investigate the options available in our new internet-charged world and embrace them in our daily work can cripple careers. Individuals who can incorporate new features into their skill set are more likely to thrive. In that spirit, I aim to illustrate what the digital revolution means to those of us who communicate. I came up with the term supercommunicator to describe forward-thinking professionals who can apply classic writing, speaking, and content development skills to a mindset befitting the quickly evolving millennium. Modeled after the Greek god Hermes, who translated and delivered messages from Mount Olympus to earthbound mortals, supercommunicators make sense of an increasingly complicated world. They turn technical geek speak into everyday layman's language, enabling real people to see big-picture scenarios they might otherwise miss. Their efforts make intimidating ideas less frightening in an era of overabundant input. Most importantly, they are knowledgeable about new digital tools that help make learning easier and can effortlessly incorporate them into their work. If you need to communicate as part of your professional responsibilities, I hope you will join me in adopting a super communicator mindset. Big picture ideas, practical advice. This is both a how-to book and a big idea book. You can improve your ability to communicate complicated ideas as you learn from the tips and techniques explained in the following pages. Whether your professional interests had to do with targeting audiences, using new digital tools, or making changes to your writing style, I'm confident you'll find solutions you can make your own. I've also included numerous case examples and interesting stories to help you see how these techniques can be applied to real-life challenges. If you're a business or government leader, this book is for you. Every day, great ideas fall by the wayside because they weren't properly explained. To be successful in an increasingly competitive marketplace, you need to articulate a clear and easy-to-understand message to all relevant parties. Financiers, management, stockholders, board members, regulators, clients, analysts, and employees all demand clarity from you. And these days, Business people don't have the interest or patience to wade through ineffective communications. Supercommunicating executives know how to touch their public with lucidity and conviction, or at least how to manage other people who can do this for them. This book aims to arm you with their tools and clue you in to their best practices. If you're a communicator, and that's a broad area, this book is also for you. Whether you work for a public relations agency, marketing department, or news organization, or you develop content elsewhere, it's in your interest to see how the field of communications is responding to dramatic changes in technology and society. What's happening at lightning speed in the world today affects the way you will do your job, more than you may realize, and very soon. This book is intended to provide you with a big picture view and awareness of communications today, along with a bounty of useful, insightful ideas. Use your judgment. To make the best use of Supercommunicator, please use your judgment. This book offers advice everyone should consider, but there are also tips that may not be applicable to all situations. Clarity, for example, is something everyone who writes or speaks in business, science, and technology should know about. However, storytelling, another topic we'll explore, can be an excellent tool to explain complicated ideas for the right audience. The method you use to speak to a crowd of creatives might not be suited for a rigid, button-down audience, and vice versa. Ideally, most of my suggestions would be embraced by a world ready to communicate complicated content more effectively. But in actuality, some organizations cling to the formality and stilted ways of yesteryears. Your judgment is necessary to determine the applicability of content in this book to your situation. It may be worthwhile for you to be a maverick and forge a new communication style for your company, yet, if you go too far, it could mean professional trouble. When possible, I do my best to point out what approaches to use for which audiences. But do be mindful of these matters on your own. Part 1. How digital technology is changing communication. Words, pictures, graphics, and symbols. The very shape of content is evolving before our eyes. The written word isn't going away, but it is being transformed. The days of straight running text on paper as our principal means of expressing ideas and delivering information are numbered as new digital tools change our communication landscape. For some, this transformation is liberating. For others, it's terrorizing. For communicators, anyone with information or ideas to share, today is a period of transition. We can now show audiences insights that previously could only be explained with words. Tools born of the internet allow us to manipulate data into forms that can bring us deeper understanding. The ease of multimedia grants even the technologically challenged the power to communicate with video, audio, and images to deliver a fuller communication experience. All good stuff. But these changes aren't likely to come easily after centuries of thinking print. Flipping the switch from print to digital requires effort on our part. If you communicate, take note. Failure to understand new media forms and how they impact the way we write, speak, and think could leave you at a disadvantage. Conversely, embracing new digital tools and the philosophy that drives them can help you thrive in our hyper-connected world. The digital revolution changes everything in communications. We can no longer think in terms of paper documents as our end product. The internet is increasingly pushing more dynamic modes of communication, not just functioning as a mechanism to deliver PDF files. Multimedia, engages users in a way print cannot, offering them greater insights. The digital revolution changes nothing in communications. Solid, time-tested communication skills are still imperative. Old-school ways to develop content are, and will always be, essential to information sharing. And digital revolution changes everything in communications, yet nothing at all. Communications is about delivering meaning. Multimedia can help us grab someone's attention. It can also enable us to deliver a more powerful learning experience by showing rather than telling. But we can't depend on killer applications alone to express thoughts and share information. There has to be substance behind the style to breathe new life into content. Technology can enhance our understanding of content, but there must be solid ground beneath the gadgets and gizmos. You may already know about some of the technologies described in the coming pages, but listen with an open mind. The introductory chapters aren't so much about new tools as they are about developing the frame of mind to seamlessly incorporate new devices into your communication efforts. We've been busy adopting new communication tools, but have we taken the time to think about how they can best serve us? Chapter 1. Delivering Meaning. We've been trying to get our arms around this whole remarkable reality of the advancements of digital communication, confesses Tom Becker, president of the Chautauqua Institution. New powerful ways to reach more people with specific information, he admits, are now a compelling reality that must be addressed. But there's a lot at stake for Becker, who knows he needs to incorporate new technology into his programming, but also must preserve Chautauqua's storied tradition of oratory and discussion. The institution has survived over a century by providing a platform for great thinkers to share ideas, and their classic format hasn't changed in all that time. The digital world, however, is knocking at Chautauqua's front door. It needs to make tough decisions about its role in a communications environment driven by technology. Each summer, Chautauqua, an historic lakefront community in southwestern New York, plays host to more than 100,000 visitors who come to participate in arts and educational programs, as well as attend its famous daily morning lecture series. Since it opened in 1874, prominent intellectuals, artists, scientists, politicians, and other great minds have gathered at this oasis to consider the issues of the best of human values and the enrichment of life. All morning, lecturers, before and after the day Franklin D. Roosevelt took center stage, have been faced with the same challenge. They speak to an audience of 4,000 with limited use of multimedia for 45 minutes, followed by a rigorous 15-minute question and answer period. But big changes are on the drawing board for the celebrated institution. In the not-too-distant future, speakers will be able to incorporate state-of-the-art multimedia into their lectures. Plans to rehabilitate the amphitheater with all the technological marvels of the Internet age are underway. The proposed technological upgrades at Chautauqua are sleek, but Becker has to make sure their inclusion doesn't detract from the human experience of people coming together to discuss and think through ideas. I think our environment is as important today as it was in 1874 when we were founded, Becker comments. But in 1874, it had to do with what is now accomplished by the digital age, access to information. People needed gatherings like this as a way to acquire access to science, history, and public affairs. That's not our problem today. The gathering at a human scale in this place today is vitally important for different reasons than we first gathered. Our ethic here, he continues, is to go into the quality of the argument itself. We ask our audiences to come to develop their critical thinking about how someone presents a problem, defines it, lays out their proposed solution, and then gives the evidence as to why that would work, and then elevates the reasoning behind all of it. Becker believes Chautauqua's model for the next century isn't about competing with technology to deliver quantities of information, but to help individuals place important issues in context and help them make better sense of the world around them. Using new technological tools to move forward is great, as long as we take the time to reflect about the message. Effective communications promote reflective reasoning by helping people open their minds to dig past the superficial and find deeper meaning. The digital age is about information. Finding new ways to obtain, analyze, and share data is essential. Providing information to audiences clearly is the essence of what we do as communicators, but shouldn't we aim higher? Our mandate should be to strive not just to deliver information, but also to bring meaning to our audience through thoughtful explanation. The lessons we learned in school, like how to research material, select relevant facts, then logically assemble our findings, remain essential in our information-drenched world. The ability to detect patterns and marshal disjointed bits of data is even more crucial in the digital age. Information needs to be contextualized, and frameworks need to be established to bring audiences references and grounding. The abundance of data, both hurtling through cyberspace and in our everyday pen and paper lives, can easily push us into infomageddon, a chasm where content is plentiful but meaningless. Too many of us forget to deliver meaning in our communication efforts. We rush to produce presentations and reports, focusing on facts and figures we believe essential to state our case, but in our haste, we neglect to tell our audience why these data are important. The old adage, "He couldn't see the forest for the trees," comes to mind. We get so wrapped up in the abundance of information available that we lose sight of the simple takeaway. Only stepping back and sorting through each element will help us to regain perspective. Specialists, people like engineers, scientists, and PhD types, are often the worst offenders. Some of our smartest citizens are often at a loss for how to explain their specialized, often intricate subject matter to the rest of us. Their communication problems can be vastly improved by understanding how to spotlight the deeper meaning among all of the details. With so many shiny new multimedia objects vying for our attention, it's easy to get caught up in the excitement of the sizzle and forget meaning. But let's remember, it's our message audiences need to remember, not our tactics. Use new tools to help people develop a deeper understanding that encourages them to think about your subject. Multimedia can be tremendously effective in helping you explain the complicated, but leave your audience blinded by thought-provoking ideas and dialogue, not the dazzle of your presentation. Failure to deliver meaning, the Higgs boson case. How much do you know about the Higgs boson? The elementary particle, confirmed to exist in 2013, was big news around the world. Physicists waited a half century for this event. The media told us the breakthrough was huge. If you read about the discovery, can you tell me why it was epic? My learning experience with the Higgs boson wasn't so much a revelation about physics, but about how many communicators fail to deliver meaning to their audiences. I read several articles and blogs that described great zeal over the discovery, yet in some of the world's most respected media outlets, no reporter or blogger could explain why this particle was a paradigm changer in a manner I could understand. It bothered me that I couldn't comprehend this story. I wondered, am I just that dense when it comes to physics? Or are these articles ineffective? So I surveyed the morning regulars at Peregrine Espresso here on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., to see if any of them got it. A group of mostly middle-aged plus guys, and an occasional brave woman or two, meet there most mornings to discuss politics, sports, relationships, and just about anything on anyone's mind. This collection of college professors, lawyers, international aid workers, government executives, a few random politicos, and a social worker turned handyman aren't shy about expressing their opinions. If this group of highly educated, well-informed latte drinkers didn't grasp the significance of the Higgs, I figured, most of America wouldn't either. My suspicions were confirmed. Everyone had heard about the discovery, but no one comprehended it. Later, a physicist I interviewed for this book, who chose not to be identified, told me he estimates that probably less than 1% of Americans can speak knowledgeably about the Higgs boson or why it's important. Frustrated, I dedicated a couple of days to doing nothing but research to discover the mystery of this famous particle. I read and reread dozens of articles and blogs to see if I could find a glimmer of light that would lead to some low level of understanding. But in everything I read, nothing seemed to bring meaning to me. I felt either assaulted by physics jargon or underwhelmed by fluff. Nothing was helping me figure out why this was a big discovery and why I should care about it. It doesn't matter to me if physics are exciting about confirming a theory. I wanted to know what's in it for me. Why should I care about the Higgs boson? If I'd been asked to write about the Higgs boson at this point in time, my summary would go something like this. Scientists are celebrating because the discovery of the Higgs boson confirms that the standard model of particle physics is consistent with what they hypothesized. Physicists use this theory to explain how the universe works. The confirmation of the Higgs boson's existence can help them better understand how the Big Bang occurred. That summary may be factually correct, but we could do much better. My readers can take away from this that the discovery is an important scientific breakthrough, but there's nothing there that is particularly meaningful to them. After hours of research, I finally came across a video clip of Columbia University physicist and best-selling author Brian Greene lecturing on Higgs boson at the Aspen Ideas Festival, like a Western Chautauqua. 18 minutes into the 20-minute video presentation, he said something that finally resonated with me. The cliched light bulb went off over my head. Greene said that the Higgs boson discovery has no practical implications of which scientists are aware. Yet. And that piece of information gave me some relief. I've been waiting for something tangible to help me comprehend this revelation, and as it turns out, there is none. Just yet. We humans crave tangibility. Ironically, it was the understanding of the lack of tangibility that finally created the spark that helped me grasp the enormity of this discovery. Green, apparently a supercommunicator, eloquently explained, "Sometimes we need to wait for theoretical discoveries to turn into practical applications." He drew an analogy to the discovery of quantum mechanics back in the 1920s and 1930s. Apparently, quantum mechanics was an abstract to people back then as we find the Higgs boson today. But Greene explained that quantum mechanics helped scientists and engineers in unprecedented ways. They understood more about molecules, atoms, and subatomic particles. The discovery of quantum mechanics ultimately led to the invention of things that today we couldn't imagine living without. Take, for example, personal computers and cell phones. Anything with a circuit wouldn't have been possible without the discovery of quantum mechanics. With this example, I now understood that the Higgs could soon usher in a new era of scientific understanding that could lead to more, greater technological breakthroughs. Now, let me try again to rewrite the summary, this time with meaning. The discovery of the elusive Higgs boson confirms the theory scientists have been using to understand how the universe works. Physicists are celebrating this breakthrough because it can lead to other significant findings, like the discovery of quantum mechanics did almost a century ago. Quantum mechanics led to the invention of many of the 20th century's most notable technologies, like cell phones, computers, and even the atomic bomb. The discovery of the Higgs boson could be equally important, if not more so. It can lead to innovations we can't yet imagine. By linking the Higgs boson discovery to tangible examples that resulted from the discovery of quantum mechanics, I was finally able to grasp some of the significance of this highly hyped science story. The discovery of the Higgs boson is possibly much bigger than opening the door to new technologies, but this simple comparison helped me put the Higgs discovery into a context I could comprehend. From here, I could grow to understand more about this great physics discovery. Finally, I found meaning. Chapter 2: The Dawn of the Multimedia Age. The early digital era, our very recent past, has been about transplanting offline material online. And that's in the process of changing. Jeff Stanger, founder of the Center for Digital Information, says many of us use the internet to deliver the same kind of content we've generated for generations. It just so happens that we're transmitting them electronically. We write documents, possibly add a few graphic embellishments, save them as Word, PowerPoint, or PDF files, and then post them to a website or send them through cyberspace to another destination as an email attachment. When the receiving or requesting party opens the document, that person gets a static document, like any other document produced over the past several hundred years. It just happens to have been sent electronically, not by mail or messenger. The internet to date, says Stanger, has been largely used by content producers as a delivery mechanism, but we're now at an inflection point to a native digital era. The internet can do so much more than just help us do research and transmit documents. There's an exciting world of opportunity for communicators to find new outlets of expression, and we've only just scratched the surface. Whether delivered on a website, through social media, or as an enhanced e-article or e-book, internet-powered applications can help us see new details or gain a better perspective on subjects that would otherwise have remained opaque. Today's adventure into a new communication frontier starts with a fresh look at how we view content development. Most of us automatically think document when tasked with originating content. New tools and techniques, along with new attitudes, are changing all that. Digital natives, those individuals that thought leader Mark Prensky describes as native speakers of the digital language, are starting to express ideas and explain complicated subjects to others through more dynamic means. Digital natives are also called millennials, the generation making its passage into adulthood at the start of the new millennium. Confident, expressive, and open to change, these fluent speakers of digital language take to multimedia with great ease. They grew up with computers. Many of the changes underway are being driven by this demographic group. But digital native or not, it's time for you to explore multimedia's benefits if you haven't already started. The internet is rewiring our brains. Quantitatively speaking, we are the most informed generation in history. As trillions of bytes of information in cyberspace wait for us, ready to pulse through our fingertips at the command of a click, we are actively rewiring our brains. Stimulation, the kind we're getting from our daily data feasts, is changing our brain structure through neuroplasticity. The internet is, in fact, changing our brains. This isn't an urban myth, but scientific reality. There's no need to worry about changes to our brain from a physiological standpoint, but understanding its evolution is essential to anyone who communicates. As writer Nicholas Carr points out, our calm, focused, undistracted linear mind is being pushed aside by a new kind of mind that wants and needs to take in information in short, disjointed, often overlapping bursts. In a short span of only a couple of decades, the internet has turned careful, deliberate readers into information hunters. Like hungry predators, we charge forward into our devices, demanding an instantaneous fix, only to lurch away moments later searching for more prey. This is very different from a generation ago, when people sat passively in libraries, carefully reading books, uninterrupted from start to finish. Words printed on paper have always facilitated concentration and sustained attention and thought. We were like content sponges soaking up knowledge like a puddle on the floor. We read in a linear manner from left to right and reflected on the content. Our role was passive. We sat, read, and pondered. We discussed content with classmates or colleagues, but would rarely interact with the author, him or herself. Our brains got very comfortable over a half millennium or so with this static means of acquiring and sharing information. The story of the singularly focused scholar, however, is quickly and most suddenly becoming ancient history. The internet encourages a more distributed and plastic form of thinking, leaving us new ways to experience information. Power scanning instead of deep reading is something we all do. Even academics confess to engaging in selective reading. Networked journal articles, rich interactive representations of current scientific knowledge, for example, enable academics to pursue rapid and high-volume strategic reading. This would have been unthinkable a generation ago among the academic elite, but with so much content readily available online, who has time to read through everything thoroughly? We've taught ourselves how to search and edit information at a glance with amazing efficiency. We go online, get what we want, and we get out. While rewiring our brains is already having an impact on today's researchers, the greatest changes are occurring among the people who will be presiding over our burgeoning digital kingdom in the near future. Hyperconnected digital natives will reap the rewards of the internet's bounty as they hopscotch from one idea to the next, fueling their creative pursuits. As they come to regard the internet as their external brain, experts tell us, today's youth will not only be more expressive, but will also be nimble analysts and effective decision makers. But all is not perfect in our digital future. There are downsides to an internet-powered brain. These same experts warn us that our constantly connected youth will more likely jump to make quick, shallow choices in their constant quest for instant gratification. Digital native or not, jump on the bandwagon. Carol Al-Kahawaji is a curriculum development pro and a grandmother. She knows that you need to embrace new digital means of expression to remain relevant, regardless of your age. As head of the school at Rock Creek International School in Washington, D.C., she pioneered programs to engage students in multimedia at a tender young age. Grammar school students built websites and developed digitally driven presentations, often in two languages, as homework assignments. The young people, she notes, take naturally to the new digital tools, but that doesn't mean the rest of us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.